My name is Astro Teller. I'm the captain of Moonshots at X, the Moonshot factory for Alphabet. A long time ago, 15 years ago now, Alphabet, even before it was named Alphabet, set up X as an innovation engine for itself to go find new, meaningfully different problems for the company to be able to focus on outside of its core business of search, and then hopefully to find solutions to some of those problems. So we call it the Moonshot Factory because our focus is on particularly audacious things that would be really good for the world and could turn into enduring businesses if we could succeed in one of those things. And we use the word factory to remind ourselves that our interest isn't just shooting very high, but trying to systematize that process, make getting at moonshots as efficient as possible. Some of the things that have come out of X that readers might be familiar with would be things like Google Brain, which was one of the things that sort of kicked off the modern explosion of foundation models around the world. Waymo, the self-driving cars, that came from X as well. And I think that's now sort of well understood as having really helped engender this sort of modern movement of getting cars, you know, to the place where they're driving themselves and can take people around without someone in the front seat. Wing, the drones for package delivery, that's active here in Europe, in Australia, in the United States. Verily, the life science business for Alphabet, that came from X. But let me give you a more recent one. We've worked for the last 7-ish years on a moonshot for the electric grid. And it now turns out that I think we spent our time well, and we're in the right place at the right time. We have what I think is the only really substantive solution for helping grid operators around the world do a better job of managing what they have, planning for the future, and starting to optimize their grids in real time. Right now around the world, there are 6, 7, 8 year wait times in most countries for, hey, can I plug this solar field onto the grid? And the grid operator's like, I don't know, I gotta think about it for a month. While they're thinking about it for a month and doing this sort of really important but very manual process of trying to figure out, is it safe to plug that solar field onto the grid? 3 more wind farms just got on the back of the queue waiting, which is why these lines are getting longer and longer. So that's an example of something where in the UK, in the United States, in New Zealand, in Chile, and other places, we're starting to be substantively helpful to the grid operators. And because the sort of AI energy interchange is so white hot right now, that's an example of something that, you know, it's 7 years old from our perspective, so we feel like it's old news. It's not in the popular consciousness right now. The team's name is Tapestry, but I predict in another 7 years, it will be as well known as Waymo. So at least to us, a moonshot has 3 basic components. There has to be a huge problem with the world that, you know, you want to solve. If you can't describe a huge problem in the world, then there's a real danger that the whole effort might be sort of academic and not actually meaningful. Then there has to be, second, a science fiction sounding product or service that you can imagine making that, however unlikely it is that we can make it, if we made it, it would resolve that huge problem with the world. And then third, there has to be some kind of breakthrough technology that you can name that gives us at least some chance of being able to make that science fiction sounding product or service, which would then allow us to solve that huge problem with the world. That makes it a testable hypothesis once you have that third thing, that breakthrough technology. So then we can go start on it. And after 6 months or something like that, it could easily turn out that this thing that we've envisioned just doesn't look as promising as we thought. That's okay. We throw it away and try another one. The truth is, we've looked at almost 2,000 ideas in a meaningful way over the last 15 years. So it's kind of like we try all the moonshots. of course, we couldn't afford to try all of them at scale. So when we look at 2,000 things, we're constantly saying, this looks exciting, and it's probably wrong. What is the cheapest way, what is the fastest way we can verify that this is not one of those once-in-a-generation opportunities, so we can, you know, with love, put it away and move on to the next one? And so the ones that come out the other side of that process, something like Waymo, the self-driving cars, it isn't because it was definitely right at the beginning. It went through that process and it succeeded all along the way. Every step of the way, it was demonstrating, oh, there's even more promise here than we thought. So let's pretend that you worked at X and you brought to me or to somebody else an idea. Now, maybe the idea is, let's harvest the power in avalanches to, you know, work on climate change. It's a renewable energy resource. Okay, that's a creative idea. High five. Now, let's get on a whiteboard. How many avalanches are there in the world every year? What is the absolute maximum amount of energy we could really harvest from that? What would it take to have transmission lines get the energy, even if we could collect it? I think we could satisfy ourselves on a whiteboard in 5 or 10 minutes that creative as that idea is, it's not really going to work. Great. Another high five for having thrown the idea away. We move on. That would not be one of the 2,000 ideas because it's not probably good enough for us to go spend months or years on. If you do have an idea and it does survive that whiteboard process, great. Here's $10,000. Here's $30,000. How fast do you think you can get this idea killed? That's what it feels like. Our teams are very heterogeneous. Both, they're very different from each other, and they have their own like little individual subcultures, because the group that's working on synthetic genomics and a group that's working on robotics for industrial manufacturing, they're just very different kinds of projects. They end up with somewhat different kinds of people. But inside of each groups, they're very transdisciplinary. Especially in the early days, they tend to have a lot of generalists in them, because we don't even know what the moonshot really wants to be when it grows up. And it's only once they get to 10 or 20 people and they've started to really figure out, oh, this is what we're working on. This is the maybe the right way to break open this field in a new and exciting way. Then they start hiring in more sort of industry experts into that group. So there are a lot of generalists, and it's very transdisciplinary. We do, absolutely. We have taken things from Alphabet and from the rest of the world. So in fact, the earliest part of our process, we refer to it as rapid evaluation. So it's not the coming up with ideas. It's fine if it's your idea. I'm not gonna stop something at X because you had the idea and if you're an Xer. And if it comes from outside, because it's not about the pride of the idea, it's the pride of the process. That's what we want to be proud with. So if you find a great idea, let's say teleportation is the thing that you're excited to work on, but it's actually some woman named Mary, and she works at the Technical University of Munich. She's a professor there. She's had a brilliant idea. So we call her up and we say, would you like to come spend a year or two at X? We would do an intellectual property deal with the Technical University of Munich, let's say. And so she, maybe one or two of her students, they come spend a year or two at X and they explore, could this really be a moonshot? Sometimes the answer is no. They go back to the university. Sometimes the answer is yes. And then that could become a really great moonshot that we have. We are purposefully trying to keep the teams at X very tight. If you spend time with people at X, they will tell you that they feel that they're being sort of like asked to work with one hand tied behind their back. And that's on purpose. Under-resourcing them is a strategy at X to make it so that the only way they could succeed would be to find some breakthrough that's so much better than the alternatives that even being under-resourced, they can still succeed. And then within that context, the money is very fluid. There are various people at X who have sub-budgets, and the answer is, like, do whatever you need to do with your budget. If you stop that team, in fact, we're having this right now. We just decided to end a project, and it was the right thing to do. The team suggested it. We're super proud of them for the work they did, super proud of them for ending their own project. So there's a trade-off. And I just tell the owners of that budget, you decide which is going to move X forward and the world forward more over the next decade. That's the question. We were originally called Google X, because at the time Alphabet hadn't been named, and X was the variable to be solved for in our minds. So it was actually written as Google open bracket X close bracket. And then once Alphabet was created, and the founders had always imagined something like this holding company, then X stopped being a sub part of Google and became like a little sister to Google and part of Alphabet itself. So we removed the word Google, and so then we were just X. But what's important to us is we're constantly trying to reinvent ourselves and stay true to that aspiration of being a moonshot factory, doing particularly audacious things, being very humble every time we set out on a journey that each individual journey is probably not going to work, but being proud of the fact that if we do that over and over again and systematize it and get efficient at that process, the net result over a long period of time can be some things that are really good for the world and that are enduring businesses that sort of grow because they pay for themselves. From a certain perspective, I think that's for the world to decide, not for me to decide. Obviously, I still believe it's working or I wouldn't keep doing it. Alphabet thinks that it's working or Alphabet wouldn't keep paying for it. And there are lots of things that you may know less about that are still within X or recently have left X that are as exciting as the self-driving cars or Google Brain or Wing. It's just because they've had 7 or 8 years less runtime, they're not as known by the world yet. But because I have seen the 16-ish things that have graduated from X over the last, 15 years, I can say that the winnowing that we're doing, the value of the things that we're getting, the goodness that they're doing for the world, yeah, I think it's working. Innovation is a real lagging indicator. You know, the time from having a crazy idea until it is so obviously a good idea and a profitable thing that no one is discussing whether it's a good idea anymore, that's often 10 to as much as 20 years. And so if you want to do innovation, you have to pre-sign up both for the mess in the early days where you're wrong a lot of the time, and even when you're right, the time between when you do the really hard, scary early work and when everyone agrees that was work well done and money well invested, there's a delay of a minimum of a decade. So you just have to sign up for that, or you shouldn't be in the innovation business. Technology is a lever for our minds and for our bodies. And technology is speeding up the world. There's a bunch of complicated bits to the fact that technology is speeding up the world. But if we're going to tackle some of the big challenges in the world, climate change, healthcare, education, those things can best be tackled by bringing sort of human and societal sensibilities with the technological levers that are available to us to find solutions faster and faster and implement them faster and faster. So I see lots of opportunities, for example, for technology to help in the race to solve climate change. I gave you an example of our team, Tapestry, the moonshot for helping the electric grid. There's a lot of artificial intelligence buried in that among other things, is taking a bunch of very noisy, disparate signals of where all the wires are, where all the transformers are, where all the inverters are, and actually figuring out inductively and deductively the circuit diagram, the schematics for the grid that you're operating. And that is a required precursor to you being able to automate what you're trying to do in a safe way for the citizens that you take care of. So that is an example of artificial intelligence helping the world and working on climate change. And I think we're going to see a lot more of that in the future.